Praise the Lord. We'd like to again welcome everybody by way of internet. Praise the Lord. Every Sunday is a beautiful time to worship and praise the Lord. But today is a special time too, because tomorrow is Christmas. Amen. So we want to say Merry Christmas to all those that are viewing by way of internet. We pray that you and your family will be blessed and it'll be a wonderful time together. Hallelujah. Jesus truly is the reason for the season. Amen. I'm going to preach on three titles this morning. Amen. You can take your pick, whichever one you like. Amen. That nice to get a variety. Praise the Lord. I entitled it Angels on Earth. Or, if you don't like that one, Angels on a Mission. Or, Angels on Assignment. It all means the same thing.
Yes.
Amen. But they just sound a little different. Praise God. But we're going to talk a little bit about that. But make no mistake about it. Again, Jesus truly is the reason for the season, right? We're celebrating His birth, celebrating His goodness and kindness to us, His mercy and grace. Amen. But I thought I'd just mix it up a little bit, make it a little different. But at the same time, hopefully it'll minister to you and your loved ones. See, God Almighty created angels to serve Him in heaven and to carry out all the assignments, amen, that He wants them to accomplish for His glory. And nothing and no man can stop Him from what He wants to do, in spite of what people out in the world will tell you. Some of them like to play God. Some of them want to say there is no God. Some of them want to ignore God. Some of them want to there's just some mean, hateful, nasty people out there. And a lot of people that don't even believe or don't want to celebrate Christmas or the birth of Christ, or trying to take the mangers out of all these places and so on and so on and so on. But you know what? Nobody can stop what God wants to do in spite of themselves. We've seen it all through the Bible, Tower of Babel, on and on the list goes. Amen. When God wants to do something. But He gives man free range because He gives us a free will.
Yes.
But it will not interfere with the will of God. You can believe that. God lets people go so far and then He puts the brakes on. And let me show you what I mean. If you have your Bible, you're taking notes. In the book of Daniel, chapter 4, verse 35, it says, "And all the inhabitants of the earth," that's all the people of the earth, "are as nothing, and He doeth according to His will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay His hand." Let me break that down for you a little bit. This is talking about King Nebuchadnezzar in the book of Daniel. When he was so prideful and didn't believe in God, didn't want to say that God even existed, and he was a cruel king and very much against the things of God and God's people. And pride had entered his heart, something like Satan when he was thrown out of heaven for pride. Pride had entered the king's heart, and he forgot that where his power came from. God even anointed him to be king, okay, of the Babylonians. And he didn't recognize that his power and strength and favor in winning all these wars came from God. He thought he was doing it all on his own. And one day, pride overtook him, and he was walking out on his balcony, looking over his whole kingdom as far as his eyes could see. And he took credit for it. And he said, "Look what I have done." That's what got Satan in trouble. "Look what I have done. I'm going to be God. I'm going to remove God from the throne. I. Be careful with your eyes. Give God the credit and the glory. Amen?
Amen.
And the king didn't. And he walked out again, and that pride took over. And God said, "Oh, really? Now I'm going to show you my power." And God struck him simple. He lost his mind, his reasoning, the Bible says.
Yes.
And his own people that were under him, his lords and captains and generals and all these things, they had no choice but to put him out in the field because he had lost his mind. The Bible said he laid in the grass and the dew of the grass. He had no place to go. He lost his mind. He was crazy. And his nails grew like that. It said like claw nails. And his hair was like eagle feathers. And on again. He was a mess. And God said, I'm going to leave you out there in the field until you give me credit and glory, because all this happened because of me, not because of you. And he was out there for years. And then finally, he came to his senses. And he said this, he said this. God didn't say this about himself, as I just read to you. This is when he came to himself and said, oh, no, I got to give God, the God of heaven, the God of creation, all the credit. And he changed his whole heart and changed his mind. And then God allowed him to come back into his mind and restored his kingdom back to him. And he said all his generals and captains and his hosts came back to him, and they gave him the credit again, and they gave, but this time he gave God all the glory. Amen. Say that. Say this. Be careful that you don't take the credit for something that God is doing in your life. To God be the glory. And as you read that, and I encourage you to read those couple chapters in between there about Nebuchadnezzar, because there's some lessons really to be learned that we don't have time to get into. But you can see how he had a change of heart and a change of mind and realized it wasn't him after all, just like it isn't us after all. It's all about the God of creation. Amen? Amen. That he gifts certain people. Just like Pharaoh. Pharaoh in the Egyptian area of that story, we realize that he thought it was all him too, but God let him know who God was. You see what I mean? So it says here, who can stop God from doing what he wants to do? Nobody. Nobody can compare to him. The inhabitants of the earth are as nothing to God. He had to learn that the hard way. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
I don't want you to learn that the hard way. Stay humble. Give God all the praise and glory for everything in your life. Because no man can tell God what to do. Not angels, that we'll talk about a little bit today. Not devils. And certainly not people. Amen.
Amen.
God is the one that created the host of heaven. And Nebuchadnezzar recognized that too. Hallelujah. And he says that nobody can tell him what to do. God tells us what to do. And he still sits on the throne, and he is very much in control, even though the world looks out of control. Okay, but God's allowing that for his purpose and his plan for these last end days.
Yes.
God's not sitting on a throne biting his fingernails. Oh boy, what are we going to do next? You know what I mean? He's got it all planned out. It's been prophesied. It's been prophesied thousands of years ago. It just happens to be coming to pass in our lifetime. Oh, hallelujah.
Yes.
Thank you. Even come now, Lord Jesus. That's what John the Revelator wrote about in the book of Revelation, after he saw all these visions of the end days, all these horrible things that are coming, all the judgments and the wrath of God falling on the earth because of man's sin, and they won't repent. And he said, my God, even come now, Lord Jesus. I'm homesick for heaven. Amen.
Amen.
So God commands the host of heaven to do his bidding, what he wants, and his will, and it's still being done today. Angels were created to serve him for his glory and his honor. We're not to worship angels. We're to only worship the Godhead. Amen? The Father,
Amen.
Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
Ooh, we see that in the Bible. We see that Michael was an archangel, a warring angel, a powerful angel. And one of his jobs, his most important job, is to oversee and protect Israel. Somebody might say, well, they're doing a very good job because they're really under fire lately, ain't they? That's right, and God's allowing it, again, for his purpose. Because if you know your Bible, the Lord said in his word that every nation is going to turn against Israel, but Israel is going to be a troubling stumbling block for every one of them. Just look at the United Nations.
Mm-hmm.
They're going crazy now as I speak.
Mm-hmm.
Because now they're doing things over there that they don't like. They're not interested in. They want to keep the Jew down, and they want to keep Israel down and underfoot. But here they say that Israel is only the size of New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
And it's taken on the whole world. Tell me that ain't God.
Yeah.
They want to kill them. They want to push them back in the sea, drown every one of them. They call them all kinds of names, but they can't. It's like God's got a bit in their mouth. They can only go so far. They're like lions with teeth hanging, and but they can't do anything until God looses them to do it. Mm-hmm. Everything that's happening now, God's permitting.
Yes.
Hey, Merry Christmas, by the way. Hallelujah! Ah, glory be to God. Woo, so Michael, we see, is an archangel. I'm not going to charge you extra for that little side note. Amen. And his job is mainly to take care of Israel. Then we see Gabriel, as we'll see later too in Scripture, that his ministry mostly is to bring messages to God's people on earth. People on earth. Again, we see this in the Word of God. We see that angels ministered to Abraham. They appeared to Abraham. They appeared and talked to David, Daniel, Moses, Peter, Paul, Mary Magdalene, Jesus himself. That's just to name a few. So I wonder, is the angels still active today? That's the main thing. Are they doing us any good? I don't mean to sound disrespectful, but what good is angels in heaven if there ain't none on earth helping us? Hello? Let's not forget Mary. Amen? The mother of Jesus. If you have your Bibles, let's turn to Luke. Let's read that for a little bit. Luke chapter 1. Let me get my other set of eyeballs here. Probably can't even see them. I got so much anointing oil on them. My God, I might get healed. My eyes might get healed with all this oil from the hang down. Hallelujah! All right, if you have your Bibles, then you're going to turn to Luke chapter 1. Verses, we'll start with verse 17 and on. And he shall go before him in the spirit of the power of Elijah. Amen. Now we're going to skip over to verse 26. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, and of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angels are very active here, came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. Oh, when you get favor from the Lord. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled, fearful, in other words, at his sayings, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation or talking this should be. You notice here, let me, I'm going to camp here and there a little bit. She cast in her mind. You know how many times we preach on the battles in the mind? We think with our mind. And she was thinking, she planted in her mind, what's he talking about? What kind of talk is this? Now let's move on. We got to be careful what goes on in your mind.